Okay, guys, we were a pretty hard act to follow. There's been a lot of digital sort of existentialistic words are being said about anything which is non-digital. But I think today, at least for this session, we are going from macro to micro. And we are going from, if to use Sanjay's sort of analogy, we are going away from digital as a platform to digital as a product or service. We're not talking about, is TV going to die or digital going to be taking over just about everything. It's going to be more, this is Pitch Madison, so it's all about who is going to be the dominant medium and by when. So we are in a situation where we said that, whatever, TV was at 37, digital was at about 23, that was in 19. We're expecting it to go to 35 for digital, for TV, and about 27% for digital by the end of next year. In a number of countries, most China, Western Europe, UK, US, a lot of them, actually digital has far overtaken TV. If we have to take our own compounded growth rate of TV, which has been at 12%, not even taking the slightly depressed growth rate that we're seeing last 2 years, and if we take the 28% growth rate of digital, we expect that digital is going to overtake TV by 2022, 3 years. Somewhere along the line, I think that this panel can actually dive deep into how both TV and digital work and actually examine some of these assumptions that are driving the growth. I think we've got a fantastic panel, and I think we've got a casting coup in a sense with the panel that we have today. What I'm going to do is, we have, of course, out here, Nitin Bavankule. Nitin was with Google from the, I think, fledgling years when Google was not even on the radar, to use a whole lot of analogies spoken earlier, to the behemoth that it is today, and he was driving revenues fair and square. And he has suddenly now moved to Star Disney, where TV, unarguably, is where the epicenter is. So from digital to seeing a little bit of both, but clearly TV is very important. So we are going to get him to just kick off, because he's got this amazing sort of perspective that he's going to be bringing from his Google days to now his Star days, and he'll kick the entire panel off with a short presentation. And then after that, we'll set it up where we've got Aditya Swami here, who is going to bring up the entire Google piece, where he's going to, I'm sure, say that give us 100% of your money. And then we've got, of course, the moment of truth, three marketers, Pratyusha, who's going to be representing entertainment, Karthi with entire banking, and the FMCG food business with Sumit. So they are going to actually give the reality check of where exactly this entire game lies. So without further ado, I will hand over to Nitin. He'll set the ball rolling with a presentation, and then we'll start the panel.
Addy, of course, has moved from TV to digital. So he's on the other space.
So all lines are blurring.
Yeah, so thanks, Vikram. I think rather than saying whether it's the existence of TV or digital, I thought I'll make the topic itself coexistence of TV and digital. That should set the tone for the discussion as well as my presentation. Thanks a lot, Vikram and Sam, for inviting me. And I think it's a great forum to have a discussion. And as Vikram rightly said, moving from pure play digital to a Star Disney, which is primarily, as you rightly said, into TV, but rapidly growing in the digital world, with Disney Plus also coming very soon in the next month, you should be able to see a lot of insight. So what I thought is to share why they would be a coexistence. And if you look at even the most developed world like US, there are two factors to remember. One, TV has declined, but not declined at a rate at which it declined in the first 5 years of digital industry. And second, I think the thing which we are seeing now is the battle of the screen rather than TV versus digital. And it's going to be a battle of screen for the video content. The only platform, you can call it an OTT platform or a live streaming platform, but the battle is going to be for the time on the screen, be it the television screen or the mobile phone. So let me show you some stats which will hopefully. So obviously all of us in the media industry are seeing a massive transformation in the last, and I think in the previous presentation a classic example of Netflix was given, and I think that is one of the prime examples of what is happening in the overall media and entertainment industry. But it's at an inflection point today. We are just about seeing the start of what's going to happen over the next 10 years. And exactly to see what we are going to anticipate is this. If you look at what happened in 2016 to 2020, 2019, the number of screens which is in our hands has literally doubled. So in India now there are close to 400 million plus smartphones. The number of TV screens are still in the range of 200 million. And if you look at 2023, the 200 million TV screens will go to 250 and the mobile screens will go to 750. Close to a billion screens is what consumers will be watching content on. So that's an opportunity for TV plus digital, because on both the platforms you will be seeing, as I said, a confluence of content either through a streaming methodology or the OTT methodology. Look at the watch time per week in India. It's not as if a watch time is going down on one platform or the other. Both the platforms are complementing each other. So the overall watch time for video content in India is growing. So it's a fantastic time if you're in a video industry in either of the platforms. Now let's look at what happens because of that. TV. I think even in Sam's presentation we saw that. Almost 613 million viewers tune in to watch TV each day, even today in India. And these are India stats. That's close to half India's population. And if you move that to a monthly basis, close to 850 million Indians watch television. 98% of Indian TV households have a single TV. There's an implication of that. On an average, 3.46 individuals per family watch TV together. India is still a social country. India is still a very family-oriented country. Viewing content together is still a big habit. And a lot of decisions, purchase decisions or any other decisions, are taken by the family or by influenced by the family. And that's why this is important. So while this is happening on TV, look at what's happening on the mobile phone. On an average, a user spends 3 hours online, and of that, 90 minutes is video consumption. In fact, 75% of mobile traffic in India is video. How does that make a difference? Sorry. Can you please?
Mom ko drama pasand hai. My roommate's crazy about romance. I'm not my roommate. And the actions are fine. I'm not acting.
The gang lost football. I'm not the gang.
I'm not him. I'm not him.
I'm not them.
I'm not you. I'm me.
My body is only what I want to see.
It's my eyes.
My mind.
Mira Entertainment. My show.
I don't go with the flow.
I go solo. Go solo. With Hotstar.
So, as you saw, while TV drives entire family viewing and engages close to 600 million Indians, there are close to 60 to 70 million Indians who are currently watching, and if I add YouTube, it's close to 300 million Indians who want to watch content on their own platform. And there's an overlap between the two. And this is a statistic which is very important. While everyone keeps on saying that digital is growing, yes, digital is growing. So you look at the growth rate, 68% increase in the chatter for online viewing at a base of 32,000. But television with a base of 125,000 chatters in a day is still growing at 15%. So that's a very important thing to keep in mind, that while both the platforms have a different proposition, both the platforms are growing. So if you are a marketer, you cannot ignore one, because just look at what the consumers are talking about TV. TV viewing in India is more of a family activity. Whereas if you look at OTT, I can choose any content to watch. So both the platforms are serving very different and very unique requirements, which enables the advertiser or the marketer to reach out to the consumer who is present on any of these platforms. So if you are a marketing person, simple. TV will drive unprecedented awareness, whereas digital will focus on customization. Just think like this, as I said, 1 billion screens. And this is a classic example. What we did, I don't want to play the video in the interest of time, but just look at the stat. TV delivered 762 million consumers. It's more than anyone or the total population which watched the results of last year's elections. And when you look at digital, it allowed you to play. So it gave the consumer a choice to do and engage with the same match. And that reach was close to 300 million. So while Hotstar platform saw the increase of consumer audience to 300 million during IPL, TV also grew to 750 million plus. So the content watching on both the platforms is increasing rapidly. So I'll just think from this perspective that advertising needs are evolving very fast, because currently, as we heard in the last presentation about Raymond's also, the consumer is wanting different experiences, different platforms to take a decision. He's going omnichannel, so you have to be omnichannel. You have to be enabling efficient targeting, custom messaging, brand safety, deep integration, real-time monitoring. All these are things which, as a marketing person, you have to start thinking now. And I think in today's world, coming back to why TV and digital are both coexisting, I think this is where TV plus digital will enable both. I would like to leave this slide as the end of my presentation, which will enable us to have the further conversation in our panel. Thank you.
Yes.
If you can just keep that slide.
Lovely. No, we'll squeeze a few things out. Okay, great. Thanks, Nitin. That was a great sort of perspective builder. What Nitin is saying is that clearly, consumers are still watching TV. It's just that people are now consuming more media, so they're watching TV and, of course, consuming digital content. Number two, he's saying that, that content is exploding on both platforms, and now people have got more options on what to choose. So how actually content creators engage with consumers is actually going to become pretty key to who's going to succeed. He's also made it very clear the relative strengths of TV versus digital. That's right in the back, so I'm not going to repeat that. Again, I'm going to bring the focus back to saying that this panel discussion is about taking positions on how much will go into TV and how much will go into digital. It's a Pitch Madison event after all. It's all about how much will be spent on mediums. So now digital adx, as Sam also pointed out, 15,500 odd crores, is broken up into display, search, social, and video, out of which video is about 4,500. And if I take a little bit of the social video, which is also to do with TV ads, it might go to 5,000 or thereabouts. Added to the 25,000 odd crores of TV, you have about 16% of TV plus video currently coming from digital. So let's first start by deconstructing digital only to the video TV part, and asking the marketers first, what is your current split of your TV commercial between TV and digital video? Sumit would like to start? We'll start with the number and then we'll get into the innards.
All right, absolutely. I think I agree with a lot of stuff that was said. TV will remain important, but digital is growing and is growing very fast. The short answer to your question, Vikram, is almost close to 20 to 25% of my spends month on month are on digital. So if I spend X, 20 to 25% every month for a food brand like mine, we spend on digital on media. So
you got 20 to 25% coming from a FMCG food marketer. Would banking be a whole lot different? Mr. 811?
So
this year for the first time we've actually over-indexed quite dramatically even for the video on digital. So we are in the middle of an experiment right now where we're 60-40 digital to TV. And this is only for the video brand part. And the performance part, which again is 60 of the total, is also digital again. So
yeah,
we are grossly over-indexed on digital currently, but it's an experiment. I must also caution that, and jury is still out.
Okay, so 25 here, 60 in banking, entertainment, and now you have to wear your marketing hat.
Yes, I am wearing the marketing hat. So it's about 15% for us. It's also coming from that we are in a category like entertainment where, and also we are very, very big in regionals. So if I were to just give a context, like last week we've launched something in Bhojpuri. Yeah, it was a Bhojpuri movie channel which opened as number one. But when I try and reach that audience on digital, it's fairly difficult, right? So that's the reason possibly why we over-index to be able to advertise on all the 9 or 10 languages in which we kind of win. So that's the kind of split.
So 15% odd is what you're saying. Adi, do these numbers warm the cockles of your heart, or are you still more greedy at this point in time?
You know, I think the way we're all looking at it is going to change dramatically. And I think the way you all are going to present your report is going to change dramatically. I think TV, print, digital, these are just mediums that we as marketers are thinking about. What is the consumer consuming? He's consuming video, he's consuming text, he's consuming experience, and he's consuming audio. I think every advertiser has to figure out what's the mix within each medium and across these four. Because if you totally want to, you know, reach a consumer, you have to use all four, and then you have to use the optimum mix. Each of you have to figure out what each, everyone has to figure out what is their optimum mix. And I, through the piece of, through this, will want to maybe share with you, are you leveraging digital to the fullest? We all see these big numbers, but do we really know how powerful this medium is? And if I can make you all think a little bit more about the power of the medium, I think I would have done my job on this panel.
But you haven't come out with a number.
Well, I think digital is going to double. Digital ad is going to double in the next 5 years. But I think the question is, we're not here in a race who's going to go ahead of the other. The question is, everybody will grow. And how do you all grow sustainably?
Okay. I'm going to leave you out of this pass unless you want to give a number at this point. But I have a,
I'm not a marketer, so I'm a sales guy.
But tell me one thing, right now, when the, again back to the marketers on this split bit, are you currently viewing, do you have a TV budget and then you have another silo for a digital budget, or do you truly in your minds have one agnostic budget and you are sort of allocating for the same task something to TV, something to digital? Now, and hand on heart, jo bhi kahunga, sach kahunga.
Haan, bilkul. Actually, for me, the question is a little different. It is not about what budget comes for television or digital. I think one of the things that, in my experience, I have seen which digital has been really been able to add for me, personally and equally in almost every role I have done, is it has reduced the cost of failure. What we have been able to do with digital is, you know, in the traditional environment, if I go back 7, 8, 10 years back, and, you know, I worked with Unilever, so... when you have an innovation, there is a certain testing methodology. You would want to be sure, because the kind of investments that will go behind a big bet will be at a certain level. I think the dynamics there has changed significantly. You can afford to fail because you can fail cheap when it comes to digital. And that's what we have been able to do. So the kind of innovations that we want to get in, which would typically have been just store back innovations at a point of time, with focused marketing, with checking a couple of markets that we want to go with, we are able to try, pilot, launch, and learn more than have a very 2-year, 3-year pipeline of doing things. I think that change in mindset has been really, really valuable for me on how we try to approach digital versus just a budget conversation.
No, but I'll still push on. If you have a, you would have made your annual operating plan, you would have had a budget there. At that point in time, did you actually think that I have to allocate this much to TV, this much to digital, or did it organically come from the process that you would have gone through to finally say, oh, by the way, the end is 75-25 that you just mentioned?
I don't think we start with filters, Vikram, at all. It's a reach and an advocacy-based planning, and then wherever it ends up being. So where we end up being is a function of planning itself. I don't think we are in a situation now that we have only television for reach. Digital can do as well. There are lots of measurement conversations we can have at any point of time, but you can deliver reach, and that's what we have been able to do.
And would you concur, is it an organic process or silos?
No, there are no silos for sure. It's but compared to FMCGs, we are very small advertisers, honestly. So on that basis, for us, it's I get to bet the farm and I don't really risk losing much. So it's really incremental budget number, and then I also get away with murder, so I get to play a lot. So it is, it's by digital karke dekhte hai na. It's like that. So it's as crude as that, honestly.
Theek hai. So basically yours, what you can afford, and then plus on top of that.
No, it's in fact, it's all in the pot this time. We are in the middle of an experiment where the bulk of my money for a new film with a big celebrity has 90% gone into digital. And then we've added TV only for markets where we thought that we needed the bolstering of TV because they were very sharply regional and there was a bias against the celebrity, etc. So we've added some other content and so on. So it's actually severely over-indexed on digital. But I am also completely sanguine and cognizant that it's an experiment, because the truth is, and this is the problem, that it's not like data is great in digital either, right? We have to believe what he says, and we have a problem with that. We'd rather that there were somebody outside telling us what was going on, and so we are also amphok poke pi rahe.
You
wanted to stir the pot, right?
Yeah, we can't let.
So, to the first
only
point.
Pointing at you because you're here.
Yeah, there are, you should. I'm waiting for this, right? Yeah.
It's about your community in general.
So, when you're planning your, doing your annual plan, making your marketing budget, I would urge you to think about a few things. How important is your first party data to your business? Do you want to use your first party data? Do you want to use your campaign data? Do you think that can make your advertising more effective? Number one. Number two, do you think different audiences need to be served different creatives? Is it broadcast or is it precision? If you believe broadcast works for you, sure. But if you really want to serve the right message to the right person, think again digital. And thirdly, on measurement, which is your point, what do you want to measure? Do you want to measure GRPs and CPRPs, which is input metrics? You actually want to measure how many people walked into your bank, how many people actually bought your cornflakes, right? If you want to measure outcome, if you want to measure effectiveness, don't believe us. Work with Kantar, work with Nielsen. They will actually show you what kind of lift it's happening on to your product. Today we have solutions for auto manufacturers. We can tell you a person who saw an ad for a Maruti car on YouTube, did they actually walk into a Maruti dealership? Did they actually fill a form? So measurement is about how we view measurement in the digital age. Are we measuring input? Are we measuring output? And I think if these three things matter to you in your business, I think you should be thinking about, you know, the share you allocate. And finally, think of your digital partners as more than advertising partners. Today, we can tell you where the next 50 ATMs should be opened. That could actually be a huge efficiency for your business. Using machine learning, using Google Maps signals, we can actually tell you not to waste your resources and where to actually plant your next set of ATMs. So there's a lot you can leverage digital, and I would say think of it as beyond advertising as well.
Okay. You've moved right down the funnel. I wanted to start at the top of the funnel. Let's start with awareness. And that's the point that Nitin also raised. So let's first ask the awareness question to Mr. Google himself. Why does Google advertise on TV?
As long as there are users on our platform, we'll be on that platform. We organize on TV, we'll be on outdoor, we are on everywhere consumers are. Today, every single consumer is you're touching digital. With 400 million people on the internet, we still have another 600 million people to go. Where we can find users, we'll be there. And I think it's about how smartly we're using the mix. And I think we're using the mix pretty well, because our today monthly active users on YouTube, not as per Google, as per ComScore, is 387 million. That is more than large networks have. I'm not taking the network. An entire network is what YouTube has, right? So.
Okay. Nitin, what is your view, like to like, of TV, the ability to create awareness? Supposing the same 100 consumers see ad on TV and say on the digital platform. Do you believe that the awareness levels will be the same or will they be different? And I'll also ask the same question to Pratyusha, who will now wear her broadcaster hat.
So there are two ways to look at awareness. The first is how many people saw my ad. That's
assuming both people, same number of people see both ads. Yeah.
The second part of it is to see how many of them remembered the ad and attributed it to the medium on which they saw the ad. And I think that is far more important, and how long do you retain the importance of that. And I think over the last multiple years, television has proved the credibility of that. The challenge on digital medium is that it's not about reach which they can provide. So as he rightly said, YouTube can provide close to 350 or 380 million reach, which television channels can also provide. The question is how many people do recall and associate that ad with a digital channel, be it
you believe TV does the job better?
Yeah, in terms of long-term recall, the TV association is far higher. And it's been.
And Pratyusha, what would you say?
Actually, I'll actually add data to that thing which he's just said. So, if there are 830 million people overall on TV, just as a benchmark, there are seven, and let me talk the digital language so that everybody understands. 740 million is mouse, and the 613 is the DAOs, and 98.5% is available for advertising, which means they actually do active watching of advertising and not a passive watching that happens. And hence you have a fairly captive audience available for you. And the decay rate that he spoke about, for TV it's about 108 days. So and let's take two metrics, okay? The metric of the short-term advertising strength and the long-term decay. The short-term advertising strength is again highest for TV compared to any other media. So it's about like a 140% over-indexed versus any of the digital media. And the long-term, so now the penny drop moment, if it's 108 on TV, how many days do you think it's on digital? Quick poll. Audience se puch rahe hain. How many days do you think it takes for an ad to completely lose its value and decay in digital? It's a little better, it's a week, it's 6 to 8 days, is the, by eighth day, completely forgotten, no effect.
Fantastic. Will the two of you validate or invalidate these claims? Do you believe the aware, for the same, they're saying the quality of awareness that you generate through TV is better than that you get online. So, sorry, Sumit, would you like to take a, and then, Karthi, I can count on you to be the contrarian. Yeah. So,
no, I think two data points. One, what we do a lot to sort of break this clutter is look at a lot of market mix modeling, because ultimately it's all about sales, right? I just want to cut the equity measures, everything else out of the way for a minute. And what we have seen consistently is that digital returns till a particular point of investment are better than television. So we have been able to consistently see, of course, beyond a point, and there are always those S-curves that you can end up looking at, but till a certain point, at least till the level of investments we have been making till now, for every penny spent, I have been making better returns in terms of sales offtake versus television. So those decay rates, etc., true, but at least for me, for now, it works brilliantly.
So in the short term, are you saying it? You get a better return, but, and what about the decay point?
See, I've heard the same data points, right? So it's beyond a point, very difficult to dispute any data points. What I am trying to right now say is that when I look at last 3 years of modeling data, which is what, or a little more if we look at it, digital ROIs at 20-25% of spends seem to be working pretty well.
Great. And you were talking about a campaign where you put 90% for a launch on digital. So would you, so a different point of view on the power of digital?
So here's what I'll say, which probably reinforces Pratyusha's data points in a very Punjabi way. Feel nahi aati. And I know it's really stupid and immature and completely juvenile to play on that and be in the presence of data greats like this and to say that. But, you know, the funny thing is, even in other campaigns where I've experimented half and half and so on and so forth, I have seen that when something's running on TV, then the whole ecosystem of influencers is palpably has seen it and has reached. TV plus cinema particularly, has palpably seen it and reached out and reacted. TV plus digital, same thing. Pure digital, ship in the night, so far. That's the worry I have. Okay. And this experiment is the most aggressive one I'm doing. So jury's out yet, I don't have the data. Next time this year I should be able to tell you.
So what is going to help you validate it? Because you're saying the feel nahi hota element is,
I'll come to that.
Is purely in favor of TV.
I'll come to the data also. So what we track, the mind metrics, we also track searches and we also track business delivered. And again we see that when it's, we are seeing so far, when it's purely digital, it's turn the tap on, turn the tap off, and it's linear. But you add TV to the mix, we are seeing a bump up. Is it worth the money? Not so sure yet, honestly, because TV is very expensive as well. So pro rata, I'm a little on the fence right now. But again, it's the game is not over. And to Pratyusha's point, if I have to wait for the decay to wear out and then see the value, it's a little while away. So next year, this time is when I think I'll be able to comment confidently with the data.
Can I add data to why he says feel nahi aata? It's on TV, you're broadly seeing the full coverage, right? The 100% coverage. And you're listening to that story in a storytelling context. And data says that 58% people believe emotional advertising and kind of are convinced better on TV. And they're also, that active viewing thing which I spoke about versus the not watching or switching off watching an ad is as low as 2% on TV. So which means, like, if I caught it even once, I intended to watch that ad and I watched it. And hence it registers a lot better, which is the reason why wo feel aajata hai TV pe. And also that threshold break even, it's also that thing which Nitin presented, right? The 3.6 people watching together, feeling good about it and talking about it, and to take Sanjay's thing on the multiplier effect. When three people together feel it's really great and talk versus one person is okay, convinced on
great.
One point.
No, great. I want to cover a lot of grounds. I want to order check one more point on this awareness building thing, and that is to do with the creative. Now, YouTube has sort of told us the virtues of a skippable, and therefore sort of built upon developing a creative where you put just about everything into the first 5 seconds. Pack shot, celebrity, message, drama, everything into the first 5 seconds. Hotstar, on the other hand, is telling us that we will give you even a 90-second unskippable, not skippable, and please, advertising was supposed to be done in a particular manner, storytelling and narrative was supposed to be done in a proper, pristine manner, you can pretty much follow it. Two are completely different. In one case, you're totally changing the way the creative is going to be rendered, and in the other one, the pristine form is sort of maintained.
No, just we don't have only that. We also offer the small second ads.
No, not to say that you don't take the others, but the point still remains that there is a, in principle, I mean, most of his advertising is all coming through the skippable. So do you have a, we will of course again go to the arbiters of all our fates by actually coming to what actually works. Does the changing the creative work or retaining the old creative?
The story arc has fundamentally changed in a mobile first world. Because you have the option of scrolling, skipping, if you're not capturing, your story arc traditionally was start with a build up, get to the crescendo, then have a close and end. That was the traditional story arc. Today the story arc is of a James Bond film. The James Bond film trailer is the best part of the movie. You see the trailer, you want to watch the film. That is the essence of digital advertising, and we also have the long form version. So that's what is the model called video ad sequencing. You expose somebody to the short form, if they're interested, remarket to them and show them the long form. You're not forcing content down somebody's throat if they don't want to watch it. And that's why, and this is not me saying again, Millward Brown published a study recently where they equated an impression on TV to an impression on digital. And their view is that an impression on digital gives you 3 times lift on brand versus an impression on TV because the viewer is choosing to engage with your content.
Nitin, you have a counter to that?
No, I
somebody taught me, so.
That's unfair.
So,
below the belt.
The first The first part is, I think, including YouTube and Hotstar, both of them offer both 5 second to 30 second or 90 Correct. Second, right? So there's no question. I think from a marketer perspective, there are two things to be, there's no replacement for great creative, be it in a 5 second or a 30 second or a 90 second. So you can run a run of the mill ad, be it in 5 second or 30 second, and it won't be noticed by anyone. So there's no replacement for great creative. So let's have that fact established. And the biggest challenge in digital platform, be it on YouTube or Hotstar or any, the fickleness of the customer. The span of attention on a digital platform is extremely small. So the moment the consumer gets a choice that he doesn't want to see it, even if it's not a skippable ad, he will change the screen. He'll just leave the platform. So you have to think as an advertiser, what is it that you want to engage and how are you engaging with the customer? So it doesn't matter whether it is 5 seconds or 30 seconds. My view is the creative matters, how you engage the consumer, be it in that 5 seconds or in that 30 seconds or 90 seconds. You won't believe, and I'll give you a fact. I don't know how many of you remember, there was a, I think 3 years back, Samsung ran a ad for their service mechanic for providing television repairs in some Kashmir or some part of it. It was a close to 2 minute creative. And I was in Google at that point of time. It had a skippable format. Normally the skip rate is 30% of the people see the full ad, but 70% kind of skip it. That had close to 70% completion rate. It was a 2 minute ad. So it all depends on the content and the engagement which you have.
And Karthi, with all, you cut your teeth in advertising, and does your skin crawl when you have to totally mutilate the ad or re-edit the ad? Or you don't look at it that way?
So I have a confession to make, and this cuts you some slack, Addy. So my most efficient form of sales acquisition advertising is a shitty email, which as a brand custodian, I cringe to even put out. But I spend most of my money on that today, because the customer I get with that is exactly as good as the customer I'm getting via Facebook, via Google, via television advertising, via my sales guy knocking on the door. I hate it. I hate the fact that everything I grew up learning at the feet of greats like you, Vikram, is really being questioned today. And you know, this thing that the great creative must be allowed to flourish is something I'd love to believe. But frankly, today I'm not so sure. I'm not so sure whether the customer gives a rat's ass. Sure, she enjoys a great ad, no doubt about it. She enjoys a great ad as if she were watching a mini web series. But she watches it and she moves on, quite likely that risk is there. Does she hang on to it and say, hey, I love this brand, I'm going to go and get some tomorrow? Jury's out. I think the time has come for the jury to be out on that business.
And Sumit, would you concur?
Oh, absolutely. I think putting the same creative everywhere is just lazy marketing, nothing else, right? And you know, honestly, if you think about it, it's not now. I mean, don't think digital, think TV in store, right? We have had those discussions saying you put the same mummy and son on an in-store visual and it'll work, it doesn't work, right? The consumer journey is different. How is that different from this? You need to know what the consumer is doing on Insta. It's gonna be different from what he's doing on Twitter, from TikTok to YouTube. You have to work basis what's happening there. And you have to tweak. So you have to have the flexibility in your mind first and then in your brand idea. The idea remains the same, but the creative will be suiting what the platform is. Has to.
I would have liked to have had a Piyush or a Prasoon on the panel.
I just want to share something interesting that I heard. So I was at a creative community and they said, how has creative changed in the digital age? And this guy came and said, think about the creative hamburger. Said at the center is great people and great ideas. That is going to be the core of storytelling. That has been there 100 years ago, and 100 years later, that will still remain. What we as creative people have are the two buns, which is data and technology. He says data can tell you who to reach, how to reach, test, and technology can let you do things at scale. And when you bite this juicy burger with all three parts of it together, that's when you unlock the full power of creative. So I thought it was an interesting analogy to think about storytelling in the times we live in.
Touché. Okay, you talked, let's go down the funnel. We started with the awareness piece. Now, marketers use the entire media piece for, yes, building awareness for engagement and performance. And I mean, from our journey standpoint, at least engagement is a little bit about getting them to think, explore the brand as well as experience, feel the brand, and maybe even express, share the brand. And of course, performance is the entire getting them to act, which is download, sales, and whatever else it might be, walk-ins and stuff that we have to actually do through performance. When we did an analysis in Madison, we found that maybe 90% of the money of our clients was going into awareness building, and now the balance, most of the 10% is actually going in terms of money spent in performance. Engagement, i.e. content and other kind of good stuff, and which actually makes you sort of immerse yourself in the brand, spend-wise is not high. Time is share of mind, and kind of the initiatives that you do is still pretty high. How are you guys seeing the pie changing from awareness, engagement, and performance in terms of how the money is going to be cut, and then within that, the role of TV and digital? So, I'd like, Sumit, would you like to take it? And especially, I think it's important, for example, you're trying to change food habits. Now, is that going to happen by awareness building stuff, or is it going to happen through pure engagement with which habits will change, or will it be through just hard sale of getting people to actually go out and buy one way or the other?
No, I think you're right. It's a conundrum that we talk all the time, honestly. Do I have a definite answer? No. I know I can measure awareness, I can measure conversions. I can't measure engagement, and that's why my focus ends up being on awareness and conversions. It's as simple as that. There is nothing else. So would I want to spend more on influencers, engagement, etc.? Yeah, of course. But I think what I know is how much conversions I drive out of awareness itself, and how much I spend on e-com and so much and other platforms to drive performance marketing. I know those numbers, and therefore I go with those.
No, so we manage what we measure.
Yeah.
So, but this is now a pretty expensive question, because if a habit change is required and you feel that maybe popular culture, i.e. integration into content, can change habits, but you can't measure it, and therefore you're not doing it, isn't that an opportunity loss?
I don't think it's about not doing it. I think, is it embedded in our working? I won't feel confident of embedding it into my everyday working unless and until I know how effective it is on a regular basis. I know it for the other two, I don't know it for these. That's what.
Pratyusha, for you, a very manageable thing for all your launches is to get the ratings and reach of your launch programs up. You also have to do a fair amount of awareness building, and you also do some amount of engagement building through the activations and other kind of, you do a lot of integrations with your own shows and stuff.
Right.
So is there a formula that you have?
Yeah. We're looking at engagement a little differently, like for our category. Actually, it's a bit like food, but for us, because I'm selling emotions, and I'm telling you that come buy into emotions every night, and it's in that sense always on behavior, and I need to convince people every day to come and buy it, like eating food every day. So somewhere there, engagement is actually just telling people that okay, the show's coming or this event is on that day is not enough, and that's actually what we do in the last 10 days. Awareness for us is actually the last 10 days. The initial 30-35 days are spent in storytelling and engaging, and the storytelling is in the form of convincing them, saying this is the story on which you want to pitch the emotion, and the whole engagement of integrating it into other content. Actually, I want to give you the Gulab Jamun example that Vivek talked about before. So we had this where Baiju's invested actually in content integration on Zee Marathi. So what they did was, in a family setup, there's somebody talking about the Baiju's app. The next week, 70,000 app downloads. So there's fundamentally, I think, unfortunately, what happens on TV, unlike digital, is there isn't a direct correlated metric. But if we, for marketers who are investing in mixed modeling, you will know the results, that there is a sales uplift that happens, which is phenomenal, especially where it's category building. Like Swiggy's example, where he said 11,000% jump on search volumes. Content engagement on TV really seems to be doing the trick.
So, Nitin, I know that, in Star, Sameer Nair at one time used to say that right through the early 2000s, the entire Kyunki and Kahani and the Ekta brand of cereals, they brought in a certain level of jewelry and chiffons and the kind of upholstery that used to be there has actually gone on and created a whole mini industry, and that it spurred that kind of growth. Now, yet we find content solution teams within broadcasters still struggling today to actually reach the mainstream. And of course, it's very, very profitable business for broadcasters because it's all non-FCT. What is your perspective on how we can drive this?
I think, I don't want to comment on what happened prior to I was there in Star, but I think there's a huge opportunity currently. If I look at the television content over the last 5 to 10 years, there's a big opportunity for the marketeers and the television content creators to collaborate and engage with the consumer. I think that's an opportunity which everyone will have to explore. Now, whether, for example, a Kotak Mahindra can engage with a content creator on any of the television or OTT platform and ensure that the consumer engagement is generated, yes, there is an opportunity. Can Kellogg's do the same thing? Yes, there is an opportunity. Can Raymond's do that? Yes, there is an opportunity. I think that's an area which has to be explored in a much better way, and I assume with the new content growth, there's a huge opportunity, and we should see that.
So we can see more salespeople in the content side.
Hope so.
Okay, just before we move tax to measurement, I want to just touch upon this brand love versus performance and sales. The entire e-commerce online business started by almost over-indexing on performance, almost at the cost of brand love. And now they're probably trying to find and create some amount of brand love. And we are actually finding that contagious because we are finding a whole lot of legacy brands actually moving their money into performance, maybe at the cost of actually building the equity. What is the fine balance that you would strive for, Karthi?
Struggling with it, honestly, because like I confessed, the sales that I can shove through the funnel with the shittiest of communication pieces, nobody's complaining about at the office. It's exactly like hiring some poor little Swiggy delivery boy to become my branch sales guy, who will also deliver roughly the same customer at the branch door. So nobody would care if I shut down brand work, honestly. It's only me and my handful of colleagues who grew up believing that brand delivers long-term value, that we're still in the game for. And there's some loose faith, to be fair. I think leadership gets it instinctively, but they don't buy it in the boardroom. They don't buy it very easily. So it's we try to mix it up all the time. So even when I'm doing hard selling for a product called 811, and I'm making sure that I invest enough brand in it, so the brand is actually under the hood for me. I can't tell the CFO ke main ek kar raha hu, par wo kar raha hu main.
So when basically, make a fantastic creative and put a buy button on it.
Put a?
Buy.
No. It has to appear to the CFO the exactly opposite. So, saam dam dandabhyad har jagah chalta hai. So, that is the struggle.
Any other perspective on actually balancing brand love, brand equity with performance?
So, as I meet a lot of advertisers, I see more and more the shift towards bringing brand love through user experience. So if I go on your website and I find your website really good, that inherently brings brand love more than a great ad. If your product is really good, if your car is really nice, I see a lot of marketers actually brightening their scope to think about the user experience. And in many times, that's what really drives brand love. And then you've got them into the funnel, and then you use all the performance marketing to get them to convert.
So build other great online assets for brand love.
Product experience could be online, could be offline, but a good product experience is the best brand love you can get.
I think that's what Vivek also said, experience before advertising. Okay, I want to get into two things before we just sign off. One is measurement and one is TV plus video kind of planning. On the measurement piece, we don't have third party measurement for digital, and
you can
can talk about video, or we can talk about the entire measurement at this point in time. As marketers, are you guys okay paying your online bills purely on the basis of what the media owners' logs are, even though when you know that if you went to a neutral third party like a Moat or a Nielsen MDAR, you could get up to 10 to 15% variation from what these two fine gentlemen might give you? Are you okay with that?
No.
but you still do it.
No, actually, you know, I would pitch it the completely other way. I think if the measurements on digital were stronger, the investments will significantly rise. So there's a trick that's getting missed in this. Intuitively, we know it works, but the questions we keep asking on effectiveness, you know, some of the questions, maza nahi aata, right? We have to get the measurements right. I mean, sitting today with the kind of reach Jio has, if I can't measure reach of TV plus online, it's a shame. Right. I would be far more confident on the kind of investments I would want to make on digital. And therefore, the digital people are the ones who are suffering, and honestly, in terms of broadcasters. We get a unique way of measuring. The confidence of the marketing community will rise many, many folds.
No, look, this is a real conversation, guys. Money, you've got to put your money where your mouth is. We are talking about digital going to be overtaking TV in 3 years or less. And then still we are okay paying 15, 20% of today 20,000 crores, tomorrow 40,000 crores, 20% of that is, big numbers.
So now, hold your horses, okay with that? Hold your horses, because frankly, even what BARC gives us, we still struggle with, even today, right? We are told that 90% of all TV screens in homes are HD TVs, and then we are told that 10% of viewing is HD viewing. And we are not able to wrap our heads around that either. So it's not just digital data that we struggle with. We struggle with television data as well, as much. Abhi kya karenge? Jeena hai ek saath, ek hi thele ke chatte batte hain.
Are wah. Anyway,
we make our bed with it, but we are not happy with any of it. We are not happy with even the print data, frankly. We are not happy with any of it, and we love great data everywhere. Third party is even better, no doubt, but I know he's made a compelling case for the opposite. But we just love richer data, so to spend more. To the point that Sam made about India being like, what, 2% of global advertising, and our rate of growth is shit for the scale of economy we are, I suspect if we had greater data, we'd grow much faster. We'd all invest more confidently. That's at the heart of it, in all mediums.
Okay, so with this setup, I have to ask the question, the two of you. And it just so happens there's a star here and a Google here. Now the entire Acom impasse happened because Google said you can measure ad, but you can't measure content. Star said, I get confused sometimes. So Star said that it's no point if you have to measure ad, you also have to measure content. I can see a lot of, frankly, personally, I see a lot of merit in measuring both ad and content. But over this one impasse, we actually have sacrificed the entire third-party system. Would you like to, on this forum, try to move the peanut forward?
Kiss and makeup.
Come on, you can do this.
Maybe I'm not the right person to take that decision at this point of time. I'm just 4 months into this. But let me tell you, it's not about Google and Star only, right? And globally, that's a challenge, honestly. I think you raised the right point on BARC, be it on television or print. And it's not only India. I think overall, measuring the right metrics for any of the platforms has been a big challenge. So even if, for example, let's assume hypothetically both of us kiss and make up, whatever, right? And the question is, who measures TikTok, who measures Facebook, who measures... There are 32 OTT players in India as of today. I don't know, tomorrow it might be 33 or 31. But as of now, it is 32. So who gets the balance 30, even if these two come on platform? One. Second, even if we measure digital video, for example, is there a way to measure digital plus television combined? Because that is really going to help him.
Sure.
Isolated digital data, even if it is 100% accurate, is not going to help him. Similarly, isolated TV data is not helping him. Only when he can say, okay, there are 300 million Indians I want to reach out across TV plus digital. How many did I reach out uniquely with a frequency of whatever, 2 or 3? I don't mind whether it came on digital platform or TV platform or whatever it is. And then I know whether the efficacy of my ad is working or not. And I think that's the bigger problem to solve rather than just Google or Star.
and that could be actually solved by one industry standard. So ACOM was exactly supposed to do that.
So I'm assuming someone will have to take that initiative to figure out.
Yeah, so I mean, just on this point, if we can on this forum sort of make a clarion call for having a TV plus kind of a product, which is an industry product, that is ACOM by any other name. And it so happens that the next session is being taken by Sunil Lula of Bark, so it gives him an amazing segue to make a pitch. But currently, even though there is no third-party measurement which actually allows us to measure both TV and online, all us agencies do have a certain AV measuring system. So please, I would, as feedback, I'd love to know, what do you feel? Are they good? Do they work? Or are you feeling a little, are you less than satisfied with them? Ratusha.
Wearing the marketer hat now. I think the TV plus digital planning really helps, because at least it's giving you a directional, what's the incremental reach that you can get from digital level.
So you're satisfied with the way it's happening right now?
It's a good start, but I don't think it's really in a place. Also, the thing is, the executions then end up happening from different people. Again, digital, the platform understanding exists with different people, and also you're investing in multiple platforms in digital in that sense. And that planning isn't coming from a single source. While the initial very 20,000 feet planning number comes on TV plus digital, the final execution of the digital plan is not consolidated. I would really love, just like data is consolidated and we have an ACOM, I think for marketeers, it'll be brilliant if I can have both pre and post eval together, then we are able to then say, to Sumit's point of, yeah, this is my ROI and how the mix works. Today, the mix is not there.
Okay. Sumit, from whatever your current system that you are using, please tell us what is not working with it. Actually, make me do a critique. What is not working and what should improve?
Yeah, you know, I have never, I mean, for the first time, I have understood or appreciated the two words of random duplication, I must say. Because everybody in some form or the other keeps telling me that. So, you know, I mean, to Pratisha's point, right, I think it's better than having nothing, right? Do we believe digital adds incremental reach to my TV plan? Of course I do, right? In the absence of any data, this works. But I hope we find something much more better than that and much more robust that we can do. That's where I would be.
Wonderful.
So Vikram has built a very interesting tool with Vishal where you can actually take your TV reach curves, you can take your YouTube reach curves and actually think about plan. It's not third party data, it's put in the public domain. But I think they're doing some really interesting work for their partners. So.
Thanks for the plug. But okay, I think we have our last 3 minutes, so we'll quickly round up by currently, from the perspective that each one of you is coming, so we've got two media owners and three marketers. One thing of what would you start, stop, continue on TV versus digital in 2020? The lady.
I think we do that as entertainment marketeers on TV. The last mile bottom of the funnel, which normally in any other category, I myself didn't believe that the bottom of funnel really was big on TV. But when you actually look at mixed modeling data and actual behavior that's happening, like the Swiggy Gulab Jamun thing, we are increasing a lot of last mile, last few days, tune-in kind of a thing a lot more on TV. I mean, it always happened. The 5-seconder equivalent on digital is the 5-second bumper on TV. I think I would bump that up a lot more. While it bleeds my heart to say I'm not going to be doing a 45-seconder, and you know, I think that is what I would start a lot more on TV. On digital, I think the customized creative dev, it's bloody tough. I know that's the Kool-Aid on, you can customize it for 60,000 people or 60 different creatives, but to actually have the insight for each cohort and actually to customize that creative is bloody difficult, but I've seen that it works when you do.
Customization. Anything you'll stop?
Oh, I really wouldn't stop anything on TV because that really, not because I'm a broadcaster, but all the metrics that we've seen, and this is also a destination kind of channel, right? So TV works for us brilliantly, so there's nothing that I would say we'll stop on TV. On digital, I think without metric, let's just do something exciting and engagement-led is something that I am brutal about with my team and saying, if it's just feeling exciting and you have no proof, don't do it.
Okay, got it, thanks. Now, Adi, short and snappy, what will you start, what will you stop, what will you continue?
On digital?
Yes,
I mean, I'm not doing much on TV.
You can't do too much on TV.
So I'm not here to talk about advertising on TV. But I would say, leverage your data more. Right? And I think today we're just touching the tip of the iceberg when we think about what we're doing with your data. So I think that's a lot more that we can do. I would say, stop spraying and praying.
Good one. Stop praying. Nitin.
I would say start thinking about reaching the billion screens, because I think it's going to be a battle of screen rather than a digital versus television fight. From a stop perspective, I think we should stop thinking about what's happening in the economy, and I agree with what Vivek said. I think the market is big, the demand is there. Inherently, our economy is still doing well. I think there's a for whatever reason, I think just stop thinking about what's happening in the industry, economy, but I think we have a chance to really, really go and blow out for the next 5 years.
We've already talked about this for our budgeting, so I'll say it. We are going to stop thinking about producing one Magnum Opus commercial for the year, but that doesn't mean short versus long. We are looking at producing multiple pieces of video and then worrying about what medium they will go on. So that's the start for this year. Inevitably, the stop is also stopping thinking about TV versus digital as a thing at all. It's really, it's video. It's like the joke I like to make is with my folks is about how it's, if you asked my 12-year-old, would he choose a cassette or a CD? He'd look at me as if I was from Mars, right? So both these words are going to lose meaning like others have predicted, I think, within the next 3 to 5 years, not more than that. So it's stupid to be having these conversations also, so we should stop. And what is the third thing you want me to do? Continue. Continue making a fool of myself in the presence of much wiser people than myself all the time. Because it's so much fun, see. Haske jayenge ghar sab.
No, just two quick ones. I guess a lot of good stuff has been said. Probably start or do more of more analytics-based decision making, whether it's TV or digital. I think that's something we need to do more of. And honestly, stop again, whether it's TV or digital, doing stuff that is not scaled up and can't make impact and just getting suckered into doing activities.
Wonderful. Thanks, guys. You've been a great panel. I hope you all enjoyed yourselves. A big hand to them, please.